Father God, we thank you so much for this day that you have made. We thank you for waking us up and bringing here. We thank you for the breath that we have in our lungs. We thank you that you sent your Son to die for us, that when we were still sinners, when we were still a long way off, you came running to greet us. You came running to welcome us back into your family. And we're thankful that we can now gather together and worship you and lift your name on high and sing praises and boldly approach your throne and sit at your feet and experience your goodness and your mercy and your kindness and your love. We thank you for that, and we ask that as we begin this time of worship and singing praises to you, that you would help us to fix our eyes on you. Help us to forget all of our weights, all of our burdens, all of the things that would hold us down, all of the things that would keep us from worshiping you. And help us to lay those down at the foot of the cross and fix our eyes on you and your holiness and your glory and your love and your kindness. We love you and we praise you, and it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I don't know who played the Sunday morning playlist this morning, but that song that you just heard 2 seconds ago is a song we're about to sing right now, so at least y'all don't have an excuse for not knowing it. Let's worship our King.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave, and you free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things, and we dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. Been faithful through every storm, and you'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again, for your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, God, you do great things. The grave, and you free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah.
done great things, and you've done great things.
Come on, sing it out.
Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave, and you free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things, and we dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things, you have done great things. Oh, God, you do great.
In
Sing a new song this morning. It's called Make Room. And the chorus says, I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. This is a song of surrender. This is a song of asking God to help us make room for him, right? This is a song praising God for his perfect will and praying that his will would be done in our lives.
Thank you. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Yes, we do. Sing Jesus. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. You are holy. There's no one like you. There's none beside you. Open up our eyes in wonder. Show us who you are from grace to grace. Fill us with your heart. In the Spirit, lead us in your love to those around us.
Lead us to those who are in need of your great love. Let us build our lives upon you. For it is a firm foundation. We will put our trust, we will put our faith in you alone. And because of that, we will not be shaken. Lord, you are so good. We thank you for this time to reaffirm our convictions about you that you have revealed to us through your holy word, that you are good, that you are a firm foundation, and that you are worthy of any song we could ever sing. Lord, we thank you so much for this time. I pray you would continue to be with us as we worship you by hearing your word. Lord, I pray you would anoint Pastor Terry for this message, that we would hear what your spirit prompts us to hear, that we would be just at your feet this morning. We thank you again. It's in your son's precious name we pray all these things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you want to turn around and greet someone.
Good morning, Calvary Austin, and welcome to church. We are so glad to see you here this morning. If you are new, we want to give you a special welcome and a thank you for joining us. It is our desire to meet you where you are and grow as a family. The best way to do that is to grab a Connect card near the front doors, fill it out, and return it to the Connect booth after service. There, you will receive a free gift and some more information on how to better connect into our community.
Good morning, church. Please visit calvaryaustin.com/give to give online. We also have text to give. You can text the word give to 512-714-3260 and fill out your information in the form provided, or you can give in person by dropping your donations in the bin by the doors. This year, for VBS, we will be telling the story of Jonah and God's big love for the world. VBS will be held June 26th through the 30th from 10 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. We are looking for volunteers to help during that week of VBS. If you would like to help, please see Dan Starling or Cassandra Vega. We will also be collecting recyclable goods like cereal boxes, plastic bottles, toilet rolls, etc. for crafts. You can bring recyclable donations to the Children's Ministry area. We can really use half-gallon plastic milk cartons. Thanks for all your help. For the months of May and June, we will be partnering with the Round Rock Serving Center to collect needed food items for their pantry. We also want to send a group of volunteers for a morning of outreach on Saturday, June 17th. This outreach team will be limited to 20 people. Please stop by the Connect desk to get a list of needed pantry items and sign up to join our Calvary volunteer team. Youth ladies, save the date for a spring picnic on Saturday, May 6th. We will be gathering to enjoy some tasty tea, worship, and a time of refreshment in God's Word together, along with some prize giveaways. Registration for this event is $5, and we encourage you to bring a friend for free. Please visit the Connect desk to register or see Cassandra Vega for more information. We invite our youth to join us at our Youth Barbecue Fellowship as we gather to have some fun and food together. This is a free event, and we encourage you not to miss out on a time of fun, worship, and praise. Please visit with Javier and Cassandra Vega for more information on this event. We hope to see you all there. Calvary Ladies, the Women's Ministry will be hosting a fondue fellowship on Saturday, May 20th from 2 to 4 p.m. Please plan to join us at this in-home event as we gather together for some fondue fun and fellowship, as well as a game of Bible bingo. To join us, sign up online or at the Connect desk and let us know what dipping treat you'll be bringing. Sunday, May 7th, right after church services, there will be a meet and greet for the Meals Ministry. Everyone is welcome. If you would like to find out more of what we do, come by for some light snacks and have your questions answered. We will be in the admin office.
To get connected into our community and events, please visit our website at calvaryaustin.com or any of our social medias. We hope you enjoy the service. Thank you for being here.
Hey, good morning, gang. Good to be here. Those are just some highlights from our visits to the Sendeo Ministry in Palestine. We've been partnering with them for many years now, and we periodically send teams up there to help them with the builds and minister to the women in the prison over there. It's a women's prison ministry, so thank all of you who have supported it through prayer. And hey, I wanted to give a mention today that many of you know Betty Swearingen, who has been coming here for many years. Several weeks back, she was involved in an automobile accident and hasn't been able to attend church other than online. She is here today celebrating her 88th birthday. 88th birthday. She's back there. Normally, I would have her stand, but she's still suffering from some injuries, and so is not able to. So, but she's over there somewhere. But after the service, give her some love. Anyways, I'm going to open us up in a word of prayer, and we're going to get into the Word of God together. If that sounds good to you, all right, well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for how you have already blessed this service. How we love to worship, how we love to enter into your gates with thanksgiving and praise, and how we love that promise that you inhabit the praises of your people, Lord. And just to know that you are here with us, Lord, that just blesses us tremendously. And Father, now we want to learn of you. We want to learn from your word. We want to hear your voice. And we pray that you would speak to us. And we pray, Lord, that this word would be more than data and information that just gets filed somewhere in our gray matter, Lord, but that these things would sink into our hearts and that we would apply the things that are pertinent to us today. And so, Lord, have your way with us, and I thank you for each individual here and who's watching, and I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to share with them the good news of your word. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I invite you to open up your Bibles or Bible apps to Genesis chapter 2. I'm kind of curious, how many of you still use a Bible book as opposed to a Bible app? Bible book. You brought the Bible today. All right. Very good. My wife still does. I've gone technology. I'm, you know, on the e-reader and stuff. But, you know, it's some people, it's like, oh, man, I just can't get away from the paper. And some of you missed the parchment, right? The old scrolls. Well, we're going to look at Genesis chapter 2 today. The whole chapter, verses 1 through 25. I've titled the message today, Eden. I'm going to take you for a tour, a virtual tour, into the Garden of Eden. We'll see what happens there. Now, this chapter actually expounds upon the creation account that we saw previously in chapter 1. And we saw how at the end of chapter 1, on the sixth day, God made man, then he made woman, and then what did he do on the seventh day? He rested, exactly. And that's where things were left in chapter 1. Is there more to the story? Well, we want to ask questions like, how were Adam and Eve formed? You know, all other creation was just spoken into existence, where God was very intentional with the creation of man and woman, where man was actually formed and woman was taken out of his rib. Where were they placed? What were they told? We know from chapter 1 that they were told to be fruitful and to multiply and to fill the earth and to subdue it. We saw in chapter 1, verse 29, where God says to them, I have given you every good herb that yields seed, which is on the face of all the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed. To you it shall be for food. Now, as we enter into chapter 2, we get some additional details. Adam is placed in this beautiful garden where he can enjoy all the fruits thereof, with the exception of one. In this garden, there are two notable trees. There's the tree of life, and then there's the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And this tree was to be avoided at all cost. Now, Adam, he was made keeper of the garden, a big ask. So he is given a companion, and along comes woman. The two become one, the first ever marriage officiated by the Lord God himself, and the rest is history. So what we're going to look at today is the history of the world in verses 1 through 7. Then we'll venture into the Garden of Eden in verses 8 through 14. And then there's a garden rule that we read of in verses 15 through 17. And then there were two, verses 18 through 25. That's where we get into God providing for Adam a companion. Well, let's begin with the history of the world in verses 1 through 7. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. This is the history of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, before any plant of the field was in the earth, and before any herb of the field had grown. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the earth, and there was no man to till the ground, but a mist went up from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And you know what happened? Man became a living being. Now, what we see here is a few things, beginning with this idea of rest being introduced. That's the first thing that we see, that God, he finished his work on day six, and on the seventh day, he rested, and a good portion of the scripture is committed to that idea of rest. And we see how the seventh day was set apart from all the other days, and that God did something special with this seventh day. He blessed it and he sanctified it, it says. Sanctified, not a word that we use every day, is it? You know, you feeling sanctified today? We don't use that word. It simply means to be set apart. We are called sanctified in the New Testament. It means that we are set apart, that we're no longer of this world. We are set apart from the world, set apart to be holy. And so the seventh day was set apart. It was sanctified as a rest day. Now, for those who interpret the days of the week in the book of Genesis as an unspecified length of time, thousands or millions of years, this is where those who take that approach, they run into trouble. Because here we see God blessing a particular day, the seventh day, distinguishing it from all other days. Six work days followed by a day of rest. Not because God needed a break, right? Not because he was like, oh man, I've been working 6 days straight. I'm so exhausted. I could really use a nap right now. No, God is setting a precedent for us. He knew that mankind would need it. You know why? Because we were put here to work. Now, some think that work is part of the curse. But the fact is, as we see in the book of Genesis, God put Adam to work right away, even before the fall. And because there was so much work, God even gave Adam a companion to help him. And so they are placed in this garden, and then they're told to care for it. And then the seventh day was given for R&R. Understand, my friends, that we were designed, wired, created to be productive. And we were also wired with a need for rest. And so God blessed the seventh day. He sanctified it. He set it apart as a gift for us. Now, as you know, over time, man began to put his own spin on the Sabbath, turning God's blessing more into a curse. All these crazy rules were introduced by the time of Jesus' day. And of course, Jesus was criticized for not keeping up with all the rules that man had implemented around the day of rest. And so he and the apostles, we read story after story, they're Sabbath breakers, they're Sabbath breakers. But understand that the Sabbath, it was intended to be a blessing, it was to be a day of refreshment, not a day of restriction upon restriction. Now your 7 day week may differ from others. God understands that. Maybe Tuesday or Wednesday is your day off, but whichever it is, you need rest. You need rest for your body. You need rest physically. You need rest emotionally. You need time for your mind to unwind. You need rest spiritually. You need a time where you can rejuvenate your spirit and have time with God, and that's why you're here, right? It's important to remember, and I'm quoting from the words of Jesus from Mark chapter 2, verse 27, that the Sabbath was made for man, not the other way around. The Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. We don't have that scripture. Okay, so those are the very words of Jesus. And they were spoken to religious zealots who accused the disciples of being Sabbath breakers. But the day of rest was made for us, for you, for me. It's God's gift. Now, Jesus also introduced himself as the Sabbath. We find perfect rest in him. He brings rest to our souls. Jesus has become our perfect rest, right? He says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Amen. He's our rest. But in the beginning, God declared a day of rest. In the beginning, we also see from our passage, there was no rain. And yet, there were plants, there were trees, there were herbs, there were fields. How did all these things stay watered? Well, there was this thick blanket of water vapor in the outer atmosphere that surrounded the globe. That was formed on the second day of creation. We saw that last Sunday. Earth became like this giant terrarium where there was this system of evaporation and condensation. So notice again in verse 6 there how this mist, this heavy dew, went up from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. This water canopy, it crashed down in the days of Noah, resulting in the global flood that lasted 40 days. Now prior to that time, it had never rained before. And so here we see thus far in our passage that God sanctioned a day for rest. He created a mist to water the earth. And next we will see how he formed man from the dust. And when God formed man from the dust, he did something spectacular that he did not do with any other creature. All the other creatures, God just spoke into existence. You know, let there be birds, bam, there were birds. Let there be fish, bam. But he formed man out of the dust, and then he breathed into man the breath of life. And that's when man became a living being. Now, the Hebrew word for breathe is ruach. Got to get that. Ruach. And it's also the Hebrew word for spirit. And so both things are true here, that he breathed breath into man, but he also breathed his spirit. God breathed his own spirit into man, and that's when man became a living being, a living soul. As his image bearers, we were created with a triune nature, body, soul, spirit. The body, well, that's the physical part of us. What you're looking at is my body. Forgive me. And the soul, that's who you hear talking right now. That's, you know, who I am, my emotions, my interests, my feelings, my intellect. You get to know me via my soul. That's a part of us that, you know, when we die, it's just our body, this tent that disappears, but everything else goes on. So the soul, that's that person, that personality. And then there's that spirit, that spiritual part of us that has the ability to commune with God. No other creature possesses this triune nature. They don't have souls that move on into heaven, nor do they have spirits that yearn to know God. I asked our dog, Neil, do you want to know the Lord? Would you like to say the sinner's prayer with me? No response. We are unique. We have the ability, the privilege to know God. We have the capacity to do good. We have the capacity to have meaningful, deep relationships. We have the aptitude to reason, to process goodness, righteousness, and truth. We understand faith, hope, and love. These are the pillars of the Christian faith. Faith, hope, and love. Animals don't understand that. These are concepts that are unfamiliar to the animal kingdom. We are unique in that way. Well, let's move on into the Garden of Eden as we pick up in verse 8, and we'll read down to verse 14. The Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it parted and became four riverheads. The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one which skirts the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is good. Bedlam and the onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one which goes around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Hiddekel. It is the one which goes toward the east of Assyria, and the fourth river is the Euphrates. So God places man in a beautiful oasis, the Garden of Eden. The name itself tells us that this was an oasis, the Garden of Eden. Eden means delight, the Garden of Delight. It can also mean pleasure, the Garden of Pleasure. It's also the Hebrew word for luxury, the Garden of Luxury. Eden was indeed luxurious. It had everything. Fruit trees, lush vegetation, rivers and streams, and gold and precious stones. Many scholars believe that this was Adam's own commentary. The description does seem to lend to a first-hand account, because we have the rivers, their names and locations, the gold and the quality of it, the trees being pleasant to the sight, the fruit being good for food. And so it all sounds like, you know, this is someone who's been there or was there, very possible. Now, there are two notable trees that are mentioned. The first being the tree of life. This tree represented something. It stood for life and life eternal. It appears here in Genesis and then again in the book of Revelation. So we find this tree in the first book of the Bible and the last book of the Bible. We read in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7, and these are the words of Jesus, "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God." So we see that this tree returns in the paradise of God. We read in the final chapter of Revelation, and this is in the New Jerusalem, where John the Apostle writes, "He showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of its street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations." So you see, Scripture is sandwiched within the tree of life, the Bible's bookends, if you will. Now, the other tree of note is this tree of knowledge of good and evil, otherwise known as the tree of temptation. Eating of its fruit would cause Adam to know evil, not just intellectually, okay, I know what evil is now, but he would know what evil is experientially, as we shall soon see. Well, now let's get to the garden rules. We pick up in verse 15, and we'll read down to verse 17. "Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to what? To tend it and keep it." I just got here, Lord, you're going to make me work? Yes. "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat." Go for it. "But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat." Here's why. "For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." Not "you might die." Don't eat that fruit, it could kill you, it might. No, "you shall surely die." So get the picture. God placed man in a perfect world. In a perfect world where people work. Again, work is not a part of the curse. Now, the crud that you put up with on a daily basis on the job site, that might be a part of the curse, but work in and of itself is healthy and good. God made us to be fruitful and to be useful. Aren't you glad for that? Or would you have preferred that he created us to be couch potatoes? Work offers a sense of worth. And so God, he gave us brains. He gave us hands. He gave us feet. He gave us skills for a purpose, to be productive. So God put Adam into this garden. We're told to tend it and to keep it, to care for it and to protect it. Again, I don't know why some believers bristle at the idea of protecting the environment, but God instructed mankind just to do exactly that. You see, all God created is precious. All of it is a gift from God to us, and we should treasure it as such, care for it, protect it, tend it and keep it. That word "keep it" means to protect. So that was the first rule given to Adam, to tend and keep or protect the garden. The next rule was given as a very strict order. God commanded Adam not to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. There were plenty of trees to eat from. And God said, go for it, have at it, enjoy all those trees and all the fruit that they bear. Enjoy, enjoy. But do not eat from the tree of knowledge. I want you to notice how Adam was given a choice, which tells us that man was given something that no other creature was given. This thing called a free will. We were given a free will. Obedience is a matter of the will. If you don't have a will, there's no such thing as being obedient or disobedient. Faithfulness is a matter of the will. Goodness is a matter of the will. Love is impossible without free will. To love, you have to will to love, and you can will not to love. Adam's will be tested in the next chapter. We're not there yet. Now, along with the command not to eat the tree, God explained the consequences. He's very good that way, isn't he? He doesn't just leave us hanging. It's like, this is going to happen if you do this. If you don't listen to me, there's going to be consequences. God explained the consequences. You eat of that tree, you will surely die. It's over. Now, he did not mean that if you eat that tree, you're going to drop dead on the spot. What God was saying was that death would rule over all mankind from that day forward, from one generation to the next. You see, Adam and Eve, they were designed to live forever. And yet they made a choice, not only for themselves, they made a choice for all mankind. They chose to disobey God, and we all reap the consequences to this day. Did you know that 10 out of 10 people die? That's the consequences of sin. And yet there was something else that died within man, that part of us that best bears God's image, the spirit within us which enables us to love, to do good, and to live righteously. Now Jesus, he came to correct all this. He came to conquer death and to give us life and to restore our fellowship with God that was severed long ago at this tree. And so God made a provision for us in his Son, Christ Jesus, that we can be born of the Spirit. That Spirit within us was dormant, it was dead, but in Christ it can come alive. And that's that part of us, we're called to be filled with the Spirit and to have our spirit communing with his so that we can live like Jesus and love like Jesus. And so that which was marred back in the garden of delight is restored in Christ Jesus, and God's image makes a comeback. Well, finally, as we pick up in verse 18, Adam is not left alone. Then there were two. Look what God does. Verse 18, and the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. And whatever Adam called each living creature, that was its name. So Adam gave names to all the cattle, to the birds of the air, and to the beasts of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper comparable to him. He's like naming all these creatures. Okay, I'll call that an elephant, that a lion, that a kangaroo. We'll call that one a pigeon. But it's like, they all have partners. Where's mine? And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept. And he, God, took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. Then the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. That's how the Bible defines marriage, by the way. There's a good definition of marriage. A man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. It says, and they were both naked, and the man and his wife, they were not ashamed. So, God's commentary in chapter 1 Everything he created, it says he saw that it was good. Let there be light. He saw that it was good. And everything that he created, it was good. It was good. The light, the land, the sky, the sea, all the creatures, you know, flying and swimming, all good, good. The creeping creatures, good. And now for the first time, God says, he looks at man, he looks at Adam, this isn't good. It's not good that man should be alone. The solution, God says, I will make him a helper comparable to him. Adam needed help. He had help working the land from other creatures, just as we do today. But he needed help on a more intimate level. Adam needed a companion, a partner, someone to do life with, someone to love, someone to hold, a helper. Now, some think of helper as someone lesser, right? We kind of use it that way today. Oh, he's a helper. You're the big shot. That's your helper, right? That's not how Scripture uses the term. As a matter of fact, the Holy Spirit is referred to in Scripture by Jesus as a helper, right? He said, you know, I'm going away, but I'm going to send you a helper. And make no mistake about it, the Holy Spirit is not lesser than you. He is the greater than you. He comes alongside of us and he helps us to bear fruits of love. He reminds us of what Jesus taught. And so he helps us in very significant ways where we would otherwise be helpless. God created Eve to come alongside Adam, to help him in ways where he would be helpless. I would be helpless without my wife, ladies and gentlemen. I truly would be. So God created Eve to come alongside Adam. And you know the story. I like to call it while you were sleeping. God put Adam in this deep sleep. He took from his side, that's significant, he took from his side because she was to be at his side, not above him or beneath him, but at his side. And from Adam's side, God made woman. And when Adam woke from his sleep, he said, woman. Woman. And the name stuck. She was like Adam, comparable, or as some of you say, comparable to him. They had a lot in common, both being human beings. And both being image bearers of God, but being of opposite genders, there were also obvious differences. Eve was not a clone of Adam. She was distinctly different, and yet she was the perfect complement. The gender differences were complementary. Adam's masculine qualities would serve her, while her feminine qualities would serve him. Do you find that true in marriage? Where I am weak, she is strong. And where she is weak, I'm strong. What I like about this story is Adam, he's attracted to Eve early on. He even celebrates. I can kind of picture him jumping up and down and up and up. This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. Yippee! She's a part of me. She's the best part of me. They were made for each other. It was the perfect match, the perfect marriage. It was the first marriage ever. According to God's perfect design, let me read it again. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Marriage is exactly that. A man joined to his wife, where the two become one. If you're reading from the Old King James, they cleave to one another. Leaving and cleaving. Leaving mom and dad and cleaving to your new partner. The word means, you know, it's where we get our word adhesive. You know, they're fastened to each other. They're adhered to one another, never to be separated. Marriage is till death do you part. This idea of joining together, I want you to think of it this way. I should have brought some Play-Doh this morning. Our two-year-old had some, and I should have grabbed it. It's at our house. But, you know, imagine I got the red lump here, the blue lump here, and I squeeze them together, and I keep squeezing them together, and as over time, not only are the two becoming one, but they are just blended together. There's no separating them. You can't separate the blue without having some of the red left there. You can't separate the red anymore. The two have become one. Christy and I next month, 43 years together. That's a lot of this stuff going on, you know, and pulling us apart. You know, it's just like we're one. So the gist of this chapter, we see three important things that God instituted: rest, God instituted rules, and God instituted relationship. Rest, rules, and relationship. The relationship that we were designed to have with God is best reflected through marriage, where the two become one, never to be separated, joined together for all eternity. That's why we're called the bride of Christ. You know, we are joined together with God. It's a union of the spirits, our spirit joined to God's. But first, we must be born of the Spirit. How does that happen? There's only one way: through Christ, through faith in Him. He overcame that which separates us from God, that being our sin. Sin became that big chasm, that wall of separation. He breaks down that middle wall of separation, and through Christ we are joined together, united in God, and we have this wonderful communion with Him. What does communion mean? To commune, you know, common union. It's compound word, common union. And so we have all things in common in God, and we are united with Him. There's this union through Christ to our Creator, this union that we might live happily ever after, forever and ever, and bear His holy image. Do you know God in that way? I would suspect that most all of you, maybe even all of you, believe in God. The God of the Bible, yep, I believe He created the heavens and the earth. I believe He created the first man and woman. I believe what He says about marriage in the Bible, and I believe in the gospel. I believe it all. But can you sit here and say that you have this unique relationship where you are joined with God? Are you enjoying communion with God? Would you say that your life has been blended with His, and that there's just no separating you from God, that your relationship to Him is that intimate and that important? What is it about your life today that says that you have a relationship with God? And that's what I want to challenge you with today. I want to take you from being just a casual to believer to someone who intimately understands and appreciates that it's more than just this intellectual sign-off, but that when you come to God through Christ, it's about relationship. Just like we sang earlier, you know, it's like, man, I forgot what it said, but there was religion in that one song about, you know, making religion and tradition what you're all about. It's not all about that. It's all about you and God personally. What is he in your life? Who is he in your life? And I want to invite you, if you don't have a relationship with him, I want to invite you, give you an opportunity to respond and make that happen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you have created. And thank you, Lord, that you created it for us. And thank you that you created us. And that before the foundations of the world, you knew us. And thank you, Lord, for giving us such a high and holy purpose to be useful. And we thank you, Lord, that you designed us to have relationship and that we can know it on such a deep and intimate level. And I pray for those that don't have a relationship with you right now. They might know you, they might believe in you, but the relationship is lacking. And I pray, Father God, that as you tap on the door of their hearts and say, please let me in, I pray that hearts would be open today. And if that is you, if you're ready to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you're ready to have that relationship with God, if you're ready to have your sins forgiven, if you're ready to turn from the world or turn from religion or turn from tradition and turn to God, I want to lead you in a prayer. And if that's you today, while heads are bowed, why don't you go ahead and just slip up your hand so I can pray for you. Anyone here today? I see that hand. Awesome. Praise God. Anyone else? Raise your hand if that's you. You're ready to just make Jesus the Lord of your life and enter into that relationship with God. Okay, excellent. Very good. Just make this your prayer. Father God, I believe in you. I believe everything I just heard, that you are the Lord of all creation. I believe that you created me in a unique way, that you created me to have a relationship with you, and I recognize that I need that and I want that, and I'm declaring to you I receive that. And I thank you that you made a way for me to have a relationship with you, a way to have my sins forgiven and cleansed. I recognize that way as Jesus Christ and his finished work on the cross. And so I declare this day that I believe in Jesus. I believe that he came from heaven to earth. I believe that Jesus died on the cross. I believe that Jesus was buried and that on the third day he rose again. And I believe that Jesus is coming back, and I want to be ready for that day. So forgive me of my sins. Today I call upon you as my Lord and my God. And I embrace the gift of salvation. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I saw one person raise their hand. I want to welcome them into the family of God. Oftentimes, there's hands I don't see. This room's kind of dark, and then I'm kind of old, and my vision isn't the greatest. And I'm always told after service, someone else raised their hand, or I have someone approach me in the lobby, hey, I gave my heart to the Lord, too. And so if you want to share that with somebody later on, I'll be around. And there'll be several of us up here after the service today to meet you and pray with you. And if you want to know more about the gospel, we can share that with you as well. But before we depart here today, let's all stand together and worship our God.
This is my
thanks for joining us this morning. I hope you were blessed today. And if you need prayer for anything, my wife and I and others will be up here to pray for you if you need that. And or if you'd like to know more about Jesus, we would love to share him with you. Other than that, you have a blessed day. Feel free to hang around as long as you want in fellowship. We'd love to see that happen. Fellowship with one another, pray for one another, exhort one another, encourage one another, correct one another. No, but God bless y'all.